Please heed my warning. This universe is already on a fast track to expiring, and you people are the only ones in the universe left alive at this point. I'll tell you my story and travels in hopes they'll help your people survive. My name is Orin. I've come from a different dimension, a different universe, trying to rescue and save as much life as I can from what I call the void. In science, you people call it vacuum decay. Except this. This is a real living creature. It swallows entire star systems and galaxies. Right now, when you look into the sky and you see countless stars, they are but remnants of life. And their final breath is traveling through space to express their last dying words. There's nothing out there for you. Nothing can stop it, and there is nothing to see anymore. It will take millions of years before it gets to you, but I can let you know it. It's all dead out there. I'll tell you my own story so you can follow in my footsteps, as it could lead to the survival of your race and future generations, but you must act very soon. Let me begin where it all began, in my home universe. A very long time ago, my people were an incredibly advanced race, where we were on the precipice of dimensional travel. My people have always had a very long lifespan to give some perspective to the entire human civilization, until this point would only be a blink in my total lifetime. Because of this, there is a wealth of knowledge that's been passed down from generation to generation. It's all being accumulated to this point. With all this knowledge, several thousand years before the Great Dying, we discovered the void collapsing entire galaxies. Our greatest minds got together in what's called the Council, and brainstormed a possible end to the void. However, no matter what we threw at it, no matter the attempts to reach out, the creature seemed unwavering and had the intent to end everything. The Council decided there was no way to stop the great devouring void, so they wanted to move on to another dimension. However, the machine wasn't done. At this point, we had very little time left, as the void was moving closer and closer by the year. Soon after, there was the discovery of a new mineral. This mineral had all the answers that we needed and produced enough radioactive power to charge the temporal machine. However, it was close to the void, so we extracted as much as we could before it could end up in the beast's gullet. The events after would lead to my eventual travel to seven other dimensions, all containing the beast, all ending the same, swallowed up into nothing. Within a few years, the Council was able to get a working model, and testing was on the way. I was part of the Council at this point, since I was the head engineer. I would facilitate the trials. The first one was a young woman who couldn't be older than 6,000 years. She was short, but perfect for the first test. She could put the suit on, and within seconds, her suit started to light up. Good, it's working great. We may only need one test for her size range, I thought to myself. Shortly after, the whirring of the metal and popping became extraordinarily loud. Shortly after, I started hearing the crunching of bone and the tearing of flesh. Her screams echoed throughout the testing chamber. Her blood was leaking out of the suit, and a mist of blood sprayed as the pressure grew on the suit. Before I could turn the suit off, it already collapsed, her whole body into a round mass of meat and blood. This was not the last trial this happened. Time and time again, no matter the size or the tweaks I designed, they all failed, each test subject ending up as a puddle on the floor. The public grew wary, and fewer people volunteered. We ended up having to pay them to have people tested. After a year of failures, The void was within a couple of hundred years, which to us was not long enough. We kept trying. Hundreds of bodies piled up. And within a few years left, I was finally successful in my first test. I started with a stout man who was 7'2" tall, 265 pounds. That being said, he was a bit nervous, knowing the pile of bodies that he was trying to overcome. We were all scared of what could happen. I was on the floor this time, and tweaking the suit to only jump to the nearest safe dimension. I found there was an issue, and the suit was low on fuel, but we decided to go forward with it anyways. "You'll be okay, I promise. I'll be here to watch personally to make sure that it all goes right," I said to the test subject. He looked at me with a nervous smile and shook his head in silence, accepting his fate whether he lives or dies. In a wave of my hand, the other scientists in the pod above pressed the button and activated. In a flash of bright blue light, the man disappeared. Now, I did tell him how to come back, and the idea is the suit needs to wait 2 hours before it can actually boot up and start again. I left instructions on how to start it manually in the pocket. We hear him say something over comms, but it was full of static. I could still make it out.
"I see blue. Clouds are pre..."
I replied to him with how to fix the issue that you can hear him slowly getting better.
"Hello, is this better?"
he said. "Yes, much better. Go ahead. Describe the area." There was a short pause.
"Sky is blue. The clouds are normally akin to our clouds. Oddly, I don't see any other beings or life. I don't see grass or trees. Just all dirt and stone."
I wrote down some other information. It was only relevant to see if we could live there, so we might be able to plant trees or vegetables. While I was writing the notes down, I hear,
"What the fuck is that?"
It was the test subject. He was screaming and running for his life. "Listen, you have to describe what's going on. What's chasing you?" I could hear him huffing and puffing.
I don't think it could have caught up. It's slow."
I wrote this down and asked, "What are its features?" The test subject was able to catch his breath and say,
"Okay. Thing's bright orange. Had four legs, with what looked to be stone covering him from head to toe. Just walking around. There's no head. I can see just legs and a body. Can I come back?"
I note all this on the pad. "All right, you can come back. Just pull the cord on your chest. Press the button inside the glove." He sighs and replies, "Okay, here goes nothing." I can hear the suit whir up and pop. Seconds later, I hear screaming coming from the admin room. I rush upstairs and find the male subject unable to speak. He was out of the suit, and the suit itself was on the ground. However, he was melded into the wall. No blood was coming out. It looked as if he'd fused with it perfectly. It wasn't until he started to flail his arms and grab people that were studying him and his effects. An hour goes by and I reported it worked only one way. But the good news was it worked. I reported these findings to the rest of the people, and with only a few days left, we all started to mass produce the suits. The only kicker is we only had fuel for one suit, which I knew, but the rest didn't. I'm not proud of this, but the void was getting closer. At the point where I fueled up the suit all the way, there was only hours left. Everyone was getting ready to start their suits. Billions of my people, all hopeful but unaware of the void that was going to end their suffering. I only hope my people got a swift death as I teleported out. I think about all my people being destroyed by the void. I wake up at night screaming and remember seeing it open its impossibly huge mouth as it swallowed the stars and galaxy barreling towards us. Can't imagine the fear they had when none of the suits worked, or the anger they had when they noticed I left and no one else. What was I supposed to do? Die? Not warn countless others? My decision wasn't a selfish one. I built the suit. I know all of its ins and outs. I know how to fuel and take care of it. Sorry, I didn't mean to rant. But I need you to read this to understand how this thing worked. My home dimension has been gone by now, I thought, as I popped into a new dimension. This one was strange. Everything was gray, but I could feel the wind. I looked at my diagnostics. It all appears there was a breathable amount of oxygen in the air. This planet was entirely the same as ours, just underdeveloped. It was getting late. I needed to build a shelter. Now, with the rest of the night, I just used the fuel that I had left to charge my suit. That was the backstory of my universe. This new one will be gone soon, but that's a story for a different time. As this one has gone long enough, I have way more to tell about the new plane. Tonight I'll be charging the suit up and laying down. Until then, live long, travelers. Signed, Orin D.
Hey there, kids, it's me, MrCreepyPasta, and I want to tell you thanks so much for watching tonight's video or listening to tonight's episode of the podcast. Quick reminder, I am also a narrator over at Chilling. If you guys like the stories that you're listening to here, then I'm sure you'll like the stories that you can listen to over at Chilling, because they're almost the same thing, I'm still narrating them, but you can select your own background music or background sounds, and you could select a whole mess of other narrators, such as Autumn Ivy, Swamp Dweller, and a bunch of my other friends. If you guys are interested in checking out Chilling App, starting up with a free trial, you can use the link in the description down below, or you can head over to thechillingapp.com and also use those free trials to win prizes from their giveaways. And as always, I would love to give a big thank you to everyone who's supporting me over on Patreon. You guys are the real MVPs. You guys keep things going, especially while things have been nuts for me over the past couple of months, and things have been getting crazier and crazier as time goes on. You guys are the ones who are keeping me sane, and I mean that with all sincerity, that you guys have helped me immensely. So, in my personal life and my professional life, I want to give a very big thank you to Jordan Alexander Sanchez, Jakob, Fenske, Chance Burnett, Diana Kraus, LaQueda, Canizales, MrCreepyPasta, PebisPleaser, Travis, Joseph Calarrudo, BuddhaBee, Dante, Kinkade, Foxhound 803, Mephistopheles, CursepoxPrimarch, Bastion Beefcake, Jeff the Killer's Cultist, Love You MNM, INSANITYgamerX, Cornejo, Yarghoul, kearns, himbojerry, SamaHigh, CrusaderChocobo, Atomaurus, Captain Scurvy, Estabine, Raiden Morris, Nate Cull, Our Minsect Time, Angelus, Seclude, That Creepy Chick, Red Shadow Cat, Xavier and Cheyenne, Six Gay Rats in a Trench Coat, Turtle Man, Cryolinian, Lord Life's Best, Goring Trimagazine, Mr. Marcus Blitz, Ike Limchok, Dirt Diver 030, Matt Bach, Voice of Sand, Shelly J, Fakamel, Deleted Account, Melted Lake, Tully Sue, William King, Sashi Sasaku, Stricken, Freddy Krueger, Happy Birthday, Jason Wilson, Lisa Cottrell, Caspian, Hades Nephew, Peter Chip, Acid System, Mog, Kiwi the Sloth, Duster's Lampshade, Nico Kyle, The Ginger Bros, and Stormcrow, Daniel Paulson, and Corey Kenshin.
To everyone on this list, everyone in the description, and of course anyone who could support even just $1, thank you all so much for making my life significantly easier with this. And if you guys would like to be able to join any of the names that you see here, or down there, or anything at all, head over to patreon.com/MrCreepyPasta. And with that, I wish you all a very, very pleasant night, and sweet dreams.